Okay, welcome back. So we saw that non-deterministic Bookie word automata are strictly more expressive than the deterministic ones. So now there are two issues that seem interesting. One is to try and understand when a language can be recognized by a deterministic automaton. So we want to characterize DBW, the set of languages that can be recognized by deterministic automata. And then, more important for practical reasons, is to see what can we do. I mean, are there stronger acceptance conditions with which we can work in the deterministic model and still recognize all omega regular languages? So this is what we are going to do now, and we will start with one. And this is a result by Landweber from 69 or 68, I think 69. And it is based on the following operator that he defined for languages on finite words. So for a language R of finite words, so R is a subset of sigma star, we are going to define an operator that takes R and generate a language of infinite words. So lim, this is the operator, limit of R. So limit of R is going to be a subset of sigma omega, a set of infinite words. Which words? All words W, such that there are infinitely many prefixes in R. Yeah, there are, I mean, in W. Yes, W has, so let's change it to W has infinitely many prefixes in R. So this is limit of R. It's an operator that takes a language of finite words and returns a language of infinite words. For example, if I take R to be all words, so my alphabet is sigma is 0, 1, R is the set of all words and that ends with one. What is limit of R? So this is going to be all infinite words that have infinitely many prefixes in R. So infinitely many prefixes that ends with one. So the limit of such an R, what is it? All words with infinitely many ones, right? What if I take R to be for example, zero, and then any number, positive number of ones, what is the limit? So again, I need words that have infinitely many prefixes in zero and then one. And in fact, there is only one such word. It is zero, one, omega. What if instead I take R to be a zero star one. So now I want words that have infinitely many prefixes in some number of zero and then one. And actually there is now, if I have such a prefix, I don't have other prefixes in R, and therefore the limit of R is empty. I see that here I wrote equal. This is not equal, this is the limit of this R, right? Okay, so this is the limit operator. It takes a language of finite words, returns a language of infinite words. And an interesting thing to note is that if I take a language of infinite words and apply the reverse operator, limit of minus one, and now it will be of L, because we are talking about infinite words, then it need not be unique. Need not be unique. Yes, if we continue with our example of infinitely many ones, I can think about additional languages, not just this language. Can you think about a language whose limit is infinitely many ones and it is not just all words that end with one? So there are several possibilities. For example, I can say that I want to see one twice. And in fact, it can be any number, but I need to finish with one, right? So if I take R to be all words that contain at least two ones, and one of these ones is at the end, and I'm taking the limit of it, then there are infinitely many prefixes like that, if and only if there are infinitely many ones in the world. I can generalize it, right? I can take zero or one star one to the I, and again, the limit will be infinitely many ones. Another possibility, I need not require one to be the last word, insist on one being the last word. I can take R to be zero or one star one, and then I have some I letters. Again, the limit will be infinitely many ones because I have infinitely many prefixes that contain different ones. Okay, so this is the limit operator. And what Landseer says is that if we consider, so for every language L in sigma omega, we know that L is in DPW can be recognized by a deterministic book word automaton if and only if there exists a language R of finite words such that L, our L, is the limit of R. So this is a characterization. It doesn't give us yet an algorithm how to decide whether a given language is in DPW, but we get some understanding on the type of languages that can be recognized by a deterministic book word automaton. And the proof is easy. The proof is easy. Why? Because if you take a deterministic structure, a deterministic automaton for a deterministic automaton A, we can define A twice, once view it as an automaton on finite words, and once as an automaton on infinite words, and it is not hard to see that if I take A, so this is my notation for A when viewed as a deterministic book word automaton, right? A is deterministic, so LB of A is the language when I view it as a deterministic automaton, then it is exactly the limit of which language, of the language that I get when I view A as a DFW. And why is it so? Is it so because if, since the automaton is deterministic, then the run of it of, on an infinite word is exactly the continuation of runs of the automaton when I view it as a finite, as an automaton on finite words. And why does Landweber's result follow? Because if A is in DPW, if I have a deterministic book word automaton for L, then yes, I have A. And then when I view A as an automaton on finite words, then the needed R, the R I need to show to exist, it induces, so R will be my LF of A. And the other direction, if there exists an R, such that L is the limit, then I have an automaton A for R, and I know that I have a DBW because A, when viewed as a DBW, recognizes L. So this is a sketch of the proof, and we have a characterization. We have a characterization and we also get some clue, the fact that there is no a single lim in minus one of L, a single reverse operator, give us some hints why we didn't have a single minimal deterministic automaton, and we will get back to this point in the future. So that was about the characterization. Now let's talk about stronger conditions. Stronger acceptance conditions. And what do we want? We want a condition that will be like Bukki, as some way to refer we have ins of R. This is the set of states that R visits infinitely often. In Bukki, we required this set to include an accepting state. So in Bukki, we wanted the intersection with alpha not to be empty. That was Bukki. Now we want some different ways to refer to ins of R. And our hope is to get some condition gamma such that the deterministic gamma word automata will be as expressive as non-deterministic Bukki word automata. So they will recognize all omega regular languages. This is not the case in Bukki, right? In Bukki, the non-deterministic variant is strictly stronger than the deterministic one. We want conditions for which we can determinize the automaton and can recognize all omega regular languages. So let's see some candidates. So the first obvious candidate would be to generalize a Bukki. So, and this is called generalized Bukki. How to generalize it? So now in alpha, in Bukki, we have a single set we want to visit infinitely often. In generalized Bukki condition, alpha is a set of sets. Set of sets of states, so alpha one, alpha two, up to alpha k, and R is accepting, run R is accepting, if and only if it visits all these sets infinitely often. So if and only if inf of R, its intersection with alpha I, is not empty, and this is for all I between one to K. So I have to visit all sets infinitely often. And you can see that indeed there are things I can do with generalized Bukki in a more convenient way. For example, if I want to accept all words with both infinitely many zero and infinitely many ones. So this is an automaton we know, and we saw that if I want a deterministic Bukki automaton for infinitely many zero and infinitely many one, I need three states, right? We even saw different automata for this language when I want to recognize it by a Bukki automaton. With a generalized Bukki automaton, it's easy if I will say that I want to visit both S0 and S1 infinitely often, then I will accept exactly this language, right? Because the automaton will have to read infinitely many zeros and infinitely many ones. So I can do with generalized Bukki things I couldn't do with Bukki, but it is also not hard to see that this can do is not an issue of expressive power. It is not, it is more an issue of succinctness. We will talk about these things too. Why? Because I can get rid of the generalization. I can take a deterministic or a non-deterministic generalized Bukki word automaton and translate it to a deterministic Bukki word automaton. The same construction will work for the non-deterministic variant. It will maintain determinism. So in terms of expressive power, I'm not getting anything. How do I do it? How do I translate? So suppose I have an n big n generalized Bukki word automaton A. Yes, so it has an acceptance condition, alpha one up to alpha k. Run is accepting if it visits all these sets infinitely often, and I want to get from it a Bukki automaton, non-deterministic, but we will see that the construction preserves determinism. So you can see that generalized Bukki has the flavor of intersection, right? I want to visit both alpha one and alpha two and alpha k, and we will do something similar to the intersection construction. We will take k copies of A. So if A, the state space was Q, we will take one copy that waits for alpha one. So if this copy reads a state that is not in alpha one, it stays in this copy. But if it reads a state in alpha 1, it goes to the second copy, and I continue with more copies. How many k copies for each set? Right, so with alpha 2, I go here. With not alpha 2, I got here. And with alpha k, not alpha k, I'm staying here. Alpha k, I'm getting back here. And I want to make sure that I'm visiting all sets infinitely often, which means that I want to make sure that I'm doing this cycle infinitely often, because here I'm waiting for the visit in alpha 1, and as has been the case with intersection, I don't care about missing visits in the other sets because there are infinitely many of them, and I want to traverse this cycle infinitely often. How do I do it? I will define alpha prime. Okay, so just to be clear, the set of states in A prime is K copies of the state space of A, and the acceptance condition alpha prime will want to see alpha K in the case copy. So I want to take this transition infinitely often, which guarantees that I am doing this cycle infinitely often. And you can also see that the construction maintained determinism. So in terms of expressive power, I have no added expressive power. They are convenient, and we will talk more about this convenience when we will talk about succinctness and the complexity of decision procedures. But in terms of expressive power, I cannot recognize all omega regular languages. And it's not very surprising, because remember the only example so far that we saw for no DBW, no deterministic automaton, was only finitely many zeros or only finitely many ones, right? We have this automaton for infinitely many zeros. And we don't have, so this is an automaton for infinitely many zeros, and we have no DBW for the complementary language for only finitely many zeros. So a simple way to do it is just to dualize the acceptance condition, and this will be our second condition we will meet. This is the Kobuki condition. So Kobuki automaton, it looks exactly like a Kobuki automaton, only that Iran is accepting, R is accepting, if and only if it is not accepting when viewed as Kobuki. So if and only if inf of R, its intersection with alpha, is empty. I visit alpha only finitely many times. So only finitely many visits in alpha. So for example, in this automaton, if I visit alpha only finitely many times, then eventually I'm getting stuck here and I'm getting the language of only finitely many zeros. So this automaton A, when I view A is a Kobuki automaton, so this is the same notation we used, but now I view A as a deterministic Kobuki word automaton. It is what I want. It is only finitely many zeros, because eventually I have to stop visiting that state, and I'm getting stuck reading ones. So, okay, we are happy we have a deterministic automaton for only finitely many zeros, but we shouldn't be too happy, because as you can suspect, Kobuki automata are still not strong enough to recognize all omega regular languages, which languages they do not understand, they do not recognize. Well, it is not hard to see. I hope that if you take a Kobuki automaton and you now view it as a Kobuki automaton, you get the complementary language, all right? So LC of A is exactly the language of A when I see it as a Bookie automaton, the complementary language. Why? Because R is accepting, yes, here R is accepting if inf of R, its intersection with alpha is empty. And this happens if and only if it is not accepting in the Bookie automaton. So deterministic Kobuki word automata, they recognize exactly the complementary language of Bookie word automaton, which means, for example, that we have no DCW for which language? For infinitely many zeros. Yes, you can try to draw it. In fact, you can even try to draw a non-deterministic Kobuki word automaton for infinitely many zeros, and you're not going to succeed. There is no such automaton. Why? Had there been such an automaton, we could have dualized it, I mean, view it as Bookie and not as a co-Bookie, and get an automaton for not infinitely many zeros. So this is the co-Bookie condition. It is useful, and it is going to be, in fact, very useful in some contexts, but still it is not a... There is added expressive power, but it adds expressive power in a complementary way, and it is not the condition we wanted for recognizing by a deterministic automaton all omega regular languages. And after the break, we will see other conditions. We will see Rabin, Street, and parity. Acceptance conditions, for them, we can work with a deterministic automaton. So this will be after the break.